Good morning. It is good to have you all with us today for our live stream worship service. Welcome to Grace. A few announcements as we get started. Keep your eyes open for an email related to next Sunday's Holy Communion distribution opportunity. So we would love to bring communion to you. And if you live somewhere super exciting, we definitely want to do that. So keep an eye out for the email and sign up for that opportunity next Sunday. A couple of other announcements. I did want to invite you to pray for our preschool this week. Tomorrow morning, they will begin a three-week session of camp with 12 kids as per local and state guidelines. And so they have been preparing for several weeks for this, and we are excited for them as they take this new step. The camp is going to be outdoors all the time. So we're excited to see them move into this new phase, and we pray for their well-being and for their fun. So please keep them in mind. As far as other announcements are concerned, most everything you can find on our website by going down to our weekly programming options and see all the different things that are available there. Everything you need for the service can be found in the bulletin. Offering opportunities, instructions can be found in the bulletin, but you can also just go to our website and take a look at the Give an Offering button from there. As far as the YouTube live stream is concerned, feel free to participate in the chat if you like. And if you have not already, you can subscribe to our channel and thereby find all kinds of cool stuff. So welcome. We're glad you're here. Please stand as you are able. Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Faithful God, most merciful Judge, you care for your children with firmness and compassion. By your Spirit, nurture us who live in your kingdom, that we may be rooted in the way of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Amen. You may be seated.
A reading from Isaiah. Thus says the Lord, the King of Israel, and his Redeemer, the Lord of hosts, I am the first and I am the last. Besides me, there is no God. Who is like me? Let them proclaim it. Let them declare and set it forth before me. Who has announced from the old the things to come? Let them tell us what is yet to be. Do not fear or be afraid. Have I not told you from of old and declared it? You are my witnesses. Is there any God besides me? There is no other rock. I know not one. Word of God, word of life.
Against me, O God, and a band of violent people seeks my life. They have not set you before their eyes. But you, O Lord, are gracious and full of compassion, slow to anger, and full of kindness and truth. Turn to me and have mercy on me. Give your strength to your servant and save the child of your handmaid. Show me a sign of your favor so that those who hate me may see it and be put to shame. Because you, Lord, have helped me and comforted me. Teach me your way, O Lord, and I will walk in your truth.
A reading from Romans. So then, brothers and sisters, we are debtors, not to the flesh, to live according to the flesh. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God. For you did not receive a spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you have received a spirit of adoption. When we cry, Abba, Father, it is that very Spirit bearing witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ. If, in fact, we suffer with him, so that we may also be glorified with him. I consider that suffering of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory about to be revealed to us. For the creation waits with eager longing for the revealing of the children of God. For the creation was subjected to futility, not of its own will, but by the will of the one who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself will be set free from its bondage to decay and will obtain the freedom of the glory of the children of God. We know that the whole creation has been groaning in labor pains until now. And not only the creation, but we ourselves, who have been the first fruits of the Spirit, groan inwardly while we wait for adoption, the redemption of our bodies. For in hope we are saved. Now hope that is seen is not hope. For who hopes for what has been seen? But if we hope for what we do not see, we wait for it with patience. Word of God, word of life.
Please stand as you are able for the reading of the gospel.
Alleluia, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal.
The Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus put before the crowds another parable. The kingdom of heaven may be compared to someone who sowed good seed in his field. But while everybody was asleep, an enemy came and sowed weeds among the wheat and then went away. So when the plants came up and bore grain, then the weeds appeared as well. And the slaves of the householder came and said to him, Master, did you not sow good seed in your field? Where then did these weeds come from? He answered, An enemy has done this. The slaves said to him, Then do you want us to go and gather them? But he replied, No, for in gathering the weeds, you would uproot the wheat along with them. Let both of them grow together until the harvest. And at harvest time, I will tell the reapers, collect the weeds first and bind them in bundles to be burned, but gather the wheat into my barn. Then he left the crowds and went into the house, and his disciples approached him, saying, Explain to us the parable of the weeds of the field. He answered, The one who sows the good seed is the Son of Man. The field is the world. And the good seed are the children of the kingdom. The weeds are the children of the evil one. And the enemy who sowed them is the devil. The harvest is the end of the age, and the reapers are angels. Just as the weeds are collected and burned up with fire, so will it be at the end of the age. The Son of Man will send his angels, and they will collect out of his kingdom all causes of sin and all evildoers. And they will throw them into the furnace of fire, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Then the righteous will shine like the sun in the kingdom of their Father. Let anyone with ears listen. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. You may be seated.
Good morning. Come in close. I have a quiz for you. It's going to be tricky. So you got to get in close so you can see. So today we're going to talk about plants and gardening again. In Sunday school we talked about this and we said, why do you think Jesus talks about gardening and plants so much? And one really smart child said, it's because we grow like plants. And I thought that that was a really good answer. Jesus uses things we know and we understand to help teach us how to live. So, here's the quiz. I'm going to hold up a bunch of different plants, and I want you to tell me, or your parents at home, or whoever you're with, if you think that they're a weed or a plant. Okay, here's one. Pretty red flower. And here's this green piece right here. which one do we think is a weed? And we've got these pretty purple flowers and this yellow flower. Is one of them a weed and one isn't? What about this pretty purple flower and this weird dried up looking thing? Is this a weed? Maybe this one? And this is like a little daisy. Do you see daisies sometimes growing on the side of the road? They're fun. It's very tricky. So daisies are sometimes considered weeds, even though they're very pretty. And these little tiny purple flowers were growing under plants at church that we planted, like weeds. And you might have thought, oops, you might have thought this one was a weed because it's not very pretty at all, but this is actually growing in our parking lot to help make green space for the water to run off. So something we thought was a weed is actually here for a purpose. Pretty tricky, right? And all the rest were actually flowers and not weeds. It's hard to tell. And that might be like you and your friends on the playground. Have you ever had a situation where someone pushes somebody else or is kind of being mean or they're not following the rules or they're not sharing? You might know someone on your playground that's a tattletale, and they might run up to the teacher and say, so-and-so pushed somebody or so-and-so didn't follow the rules. And a lot of the time, your teachers say, worry about yourself, pay attention to yourself, I'll watch out for them. You just keep playing and you just keep doing what you were doing. I'll watch out for the kids who are not listening. And I think that's a little bit like the story that Jesus tells today. It's about us not judging other people. It's not our job to say what's right and what's wrong, or who should play on the playground and who shouldn't. That's not for us to worry about. Just like the weeds that we can't tell if they're flowers or weeds, it's hard for us to know what's useful or what's not useful, or what's helpful or not helpful. And so it's not our job to judge people. It's our job to love people and to help people and care for people. And so I think that's what Jesus is trying to tell us in the story today. Let's say a prayer. Dear God, thank you for grace. You have sent your Son for all people. Help us to love as you do, to not judge one another, and to bring others to the knowledge of you. Thank you for your love. In Jesus' name, amen.
The text that we have today was kind of funny, particularly at our early morning prayer service in the courtyard. Many of the commentators pointed out that in English, the words wheat and weed are hard to distinguish. Weed, wheat, weed, wheat. You see, it sounds pretty much the same. Now, if everybody is wearing masks also, you can't tell the difference at all. So there's a challenge, right? That identifying weeds amidst wheat and how we deal with that. When I was growing up in suburban Chicago, my mom had a very large garden in the backyard, and there was a lot of work that was involved in that. But one of the things that struck me was that weeding a garden is not always as obvious as you think it is. Particularly when you're young, there's a certain amount of, shall we say, enthusiasm for weeding, which could end up with a scenario if a parent or someone is not supervising closely, you could end up with a garden that has no plants in it at all, right? Because how do you know if you're making progress, if you're pulling out everything that's green, right? Sense of making forward motion and progress. This idea of weeds and wheat in this story are challenging and rather starkly worded as Jesus begins to convey and explain his parable. But when we put it together with Paul's reading, as we understand spirit and flesh, the challenges that we have within our own hearts to follow God and to understand how God is calling us to be in this world at this time and in this place. We are mindful that the weeds and the wheat are not distinctions between people so much as they are challenges we face within our own hearts. One of the things that I was reading as I prepared for the sermon this week was a comment that was made by Pastor Jonathan Brooks out of Chicago. He had an expression that fits this perfectly. He said, usually when it's nighttime and we walk into a room, we're not walking into the room with the intention of turning off the dark. The idea is that we're going into that room to turn on the light. I would argue that as human beings, we often love to spend our lives trying to turn off the dark, trying to weed this world, trying to tear out all kinds of things, perhaps with more toddler, preschool, elementary school understandings of what is a weed in a garden. We like this idea of weeding. We like it a lot. In fact, in the United States, we're really, really, really good at it. In fact, with just under 5% of the world's population, we have almost 25% of the world's prison population. We love to weed. In fact, we love it so much that just this last week, in all of our names, for the first time in 17 years, three prisoners were executed by the federal government because we love to weed, and the darkness needs to be turned out in this room. Ouch. Ouch, right? What does that type of living do to the ones doing the weeding? What does this type of living doing to those for whom the weeds are perhaps in their hearts? The weeds are in all of our hearts. All of our hearts. But we take a special glee in pointing it out in the hearts of others. This is not a simple thing. How do we act in this world in a way that nurtures the wheat and works against the weeds, but perhaps not in an overzealous sort of way, like we as human beings seem to take a certain joy in? There is a quote from Pastor Martin Luther King Jr. from his 1967 Christmas Eve sermon that I would like to share. It touches on this idea of what it means to be in the business of encouraging the wheat as over and against the image of weeding. To our most bitter opponents, we say, we shall match your capacity to inflict suffering by our capacity to endure suffering. We shall meet your physical force with soul force. Do to us what you will, and we shall continue to love you. We cannot in good conscience obey your unjust laws, because non-cooperation with evil is as much a moral obligation as is cooperation with good. Throw us into jail, and we shall still love you. As we look at the text that we have for today, the angels, the servants of the Master, are excited to get at the business of weeding. We are excited about the business of weeding. But we need to take a step back. God has shown us mercy. We are called to bring mercy. In the first Gulf War, I'll never forget, one of our senators said, it's time to bring Saddam Hussein the gospel. And by gospel, I don't think it was meant to bring good news. But it's an indication, perhaps, of how we as human beings twist our role in society. When I worked as a camp counselor, we had a simple way of describing this. We wanted to discourage campers from running on some of the paths on site because they were quite steep and somebody could fall and hurt themselves quite badly. And so you would often, in the first week or two of camp, hear a counselor call out, "Stop running! Stop running!" And we would always encourage the staff to say, "Please walk. Please walk." Do we encourage walking or do we punish running? Are we spending all of our time and passion and energy trying to turn off the dark? Or are we doing it in a way that turns on the light? In Sunday school as a kid, we all learned that song, right? This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. Jesus didn't come into the world to condemn the world, as John says. We were not recruited as followers of Christ, seeking to go out and weed the world and punish. But rather, we have been called to nurture the grains of wheat in every heart. In every heart, that fruit might be born and that weeds might be diminished. As you think about your role in this world, in this coming week, think about how you might be encouraging the wheat and perhaps ways in which you have been actively involved in weeding in this world that maybe you should take a step back from. There's a prayer in the tradition of the church that has been attributed to St. Francis of Assisi, and I'd like to wrap up my sermon by sharing it. It talks about seeds, and it talks what it means to be about the waging of peace, the turning on of light, the nurturing of fruit, the ability to bring grace and mercy as Christ did. Let us pray. Lord, make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. Where there is sadness, joy. O divine master, grant that I may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive. It is in pardoning that we are pardoned. And it is in dying that we are born to eternal life. Amen. Please stand as you are able. Let us confess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, and suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Confident of your care and helped by the Holy Spirit, we pray for the Church, the world, and all who are in need. God of the harvest, you sow the good seed of the gospel of Jesus Christ into your field. Help your church throughout the world to be both diligent and patient, full of resolve and gentleness, that our witness may be faithful to your intentions. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. God of all space and time, your whole creation groans in labor pains, awaiting the gift of new birth. Give us your passion to work with you in renewing the earth, sky, and sea, so that all your creation experiences freedom from the bondage of decay. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. God of the nations, teach us your ways, that we may walk in your truth. Mend the fabric of the human family, now torn apart by our fearful and warring ways. Call us to your mercy, grace, and steadfast love. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. God of hope, you accompany those who suffer and are near to the brokenhearted. Open our hearts to your children who are lonely and abandoned, who feel trapped by despair, and all who suffer in any way, especially Patty's friend Virginia, and all those we name in our hearts or out loud now. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. God of the seasons, in the midst of summer, we pray for your protecting arms and joyous heart as our preschool begins their camp tomorrow. May your presence be felt in laughter and fun. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. God of life, those who have died in you shine like the sun in your endless kingdom. We remember with thanksgiving the saints of all times and places, and saints close to us, especially the Reverend John Lewis, Georgia Congressman. Gather us with them on the day of salvation. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. In the certain hope that nothing can separate us from your love, we offer these prayers to you through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Let's take a moment and share that peace with those who are with you and on the chat window as well. Peace be with you. Peace, Tim. Andrew, peace. As you are seated for the offering, instructions on giving an offering can be found in the bulletin right at this spot. Also, you can go to our website and find the giving link there as well.
Mercy. Jesus taught me when a stranger wandering from the fold of God, me to rescue me from danger, interposed his precious blood.
Stand as you are able. O God of justice and love, we give thanks to you that you illumine our way through life with the words of your Son. Give us the light we need, awaken us to the needs of others, and at the end bring all the world to your feast. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory forever. Amen. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present nor things to come, nor powers, nor height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. God the Creator, Jesus the Christ, and the Holy Spirit the Comforter, bless you and keep you in eternal love. Amen. Go in peace. Christ is with you. Thanks be to God.